We'll just share.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to a serious slumber party about boys, which is a panel about masculinity in games. And I have a panel of experts on masculinity joining me. would you like to just introduce yourselves, like, one by one, starting with Felix?
Sure. Wow, this is really loud. It's making up for yours. So my name is Felix. I am a developer and producer in indie games. And I'm, like, represent right now as, like, where all my MBs in the audience. Good old MBs. Yeah. Yeah, MB represent. So I'm non-binary. So therefore I use they pronouns. And that'll come into play later. I'm sure I'll talk about that a bunch. But that's the context for this.
Hi, everybody. I'm Robert Moore. I am a professional shitposter. And sometimes in a blue moon, I'm a game developer. I am a cis man, so all my pronouns are he. I'm also probably the least qualified person to be up here, let's be honest.
Please.
But thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Right. Your mic works.
My name's Riley. I guess I'm a games writer now. I'm a trans guy. My pronouns are he. Prior to this, I used to run a trans press called Topside. We made Nevada, which everybody's read. And yes. I write things about games.
Yay.
On the internet.
Hooray.
I'm Rokashi. I'm a developer. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yes. Nice. I wanted to start off just asking all of you what, when you think about the term masculinity, what does it really mean to you personally? How do you approach that term, and what does it mean to you?
Are we doing one by one?
Yeah, why not?
Sure. So masculinity for me has always been a complex issue, if only because growing up as someone who definitely did not, who understood that they were not, they're assigned at birth gender, and I was trying to fit in some group, living in like a very binary world, especially in elementary school, when you're really young and forming your opinions of the world around you, masculinity started to become really complex. Why am I sitting with my bad leg down? For me, masculinity has these like levels. It's got like lots of subtlety, and I found that really difficult to explain to my 9-year-old friends on the playground, especially the boys. Actually, everyone. Because I was like, oh, well, you know, being like, quote unquote, one of the guys or something, like expressing your masculinity as a kid is really white or black in a lot of situations. So for me, masculinity is this layered expression, I'd say, that I'm hopefully learning more about now and understanding myself and the world around me and what we'd consider to be like a social idea of masculinity versus a personal one. And I think that they exist independently of each other and not necessarily always like simultaneous. Like not you can't map those two things on top of each other, your personal representation and an outside external representation. So I know that's not quite an answer, but it's vague because my interpretation of masculinity is vague.
Okay. Sorry.
Ooh, I gotta follow that one up. When I think masculinity in games, I think at the moment it's kind of just a binary checkbox. You have two types. There's not much variance. You don't really, in a medium where we have the ability to express masculinity in various forms as it is represented in life in various forms, we somehow wound up in the track that we want to create the action movie star and nothing else. And when there is the variation that someone does somehow wind up with the wild hair, oh, let's do something different, it always seems to just be derided and fall apart immediately. So for me, masculinity is this strange concept where one is correct and everything else is not, and no one can seem to explain why this one is correct or how we reached that one in the first place. That's not really an answer either, now that you meant to think about it. It's a circle. It's a circular answer. It's something.
When I think masculinity in games, it's hard. I think I found that as a trans guy in games, mostly when we talk about trans things in games, we talk about trans women and trans femininity, which I am like super, super for. But also like my standard line about this is I often feel like I don't know who to sit with at lunch, where I feel like when we talk about trans stuff, we talk about stuff about women, which I'm like super happy for. And I think often when we talk about masculinity in games, we talk about sort of the negative aspects, and as someone who consciously chose masculinity a long time ago, granted being much less savvy about feminism and things than I am now, I'm obviously like very for it, but also struggle really hard to understand what's positive about it. And so I think, I guess if you were to say masculinity in games and ask me what I think, I'd be like, I feel weird a lot. Yeah. I don't know. Constantly. I just feel weird a whole bunch. And yeah, and that's tricky, I think.
Whenever I think about masculinity in games, I try to put myself into, you know, the place of those characters, but most of the time, it's like I'm looking at a mirror, but it's like very foggy. I don't see how representation, I just don't feel like it represents who I am. But at the same time, you realize that, you know, there's so many different kinds of people out there and they're all playing that same thing. And you wonder, you know, how are people gonna interpret that? Like, are they gonna be like, oh yeah, that's totally what masculinity is. I wanna like, mm-hmm. you know, adhere to something like that. But I feel like it's way more complex than that. And it's very hard to find that line of like, you know, taking it way too far or, you know, being criticized for, you know, not going far enough.
Mm-hmm. I mean, sorry, I was gonna ask a question. Do folks, I'm just like taking over your role. Do folks feel like there are positive masculinities in games? Like, is there, I mean, I guess I could speak to this or you could go instead of me.
Well, I mean, that's like a really good question.
That's a terrible question.
Yeah, I mean, it's really tough to find them, right? So I think, yeah. I don't know if this derails what we were gonna say.
No,
cool. So I think, it's really hard to find, we've all played lots of games, it's really hard to go in and find a representation of masculinity that is outside of a certain box. Like, it's really easy to find, obviously, lots of representation of men in games, which is a very different thing from, like, a positive either role model or representation of being masculine or being a man. And you can find them. But what's extra strange about that is that you sort of come into it from a, if the easiest thing to do to get outside of that box is to have a man, quote unquote, act like a woman, like whatever the fuck that means, and then suddenly someone's like, yeah, that person is outside the box, and you're like, well, okay, we still haven't touched on, yeah. Like, yeah, it's
they're just in a different box,
right? Yeah, you didn't do anything. Yeah, you didn't do anything. So yeah, I think people would like to think so. Like, it's something that oftentimes doesn't get thought about in the same way, especially or critiqued in the same way or discussed in circles in the same way. Not to say that it isn't important, just that it's something that we're just not there yet. Like, we just haven't gotten there into that discussion yet. So it's kind of cool to have, especially like a chat. I don't know if we mentioned that this was going to be like a chat. I'm not going to start referencing like studies and pulling up stats and stuff like that. This is really gonna be way more of a casual thing. Didn't read it, Robert didn't read any, so. And we kind of talked about this before, right? Like, we were all discussing what we wanted this panel to be, and it's really easy to come in and sort of pull up a bunch of articles on cause and effect and like men represented in games and how that might be affecting young people or just anybody who plays them, and that's like, it's a dangerous conversation to have because we haven't studied it enough. Like, it's a dangerous conversation to go in and be like, there's a cause and effect in violence in games because of these like really violent representations of men and whatever. Like, you can start that conversation, but I don't actually know where it leads other than we need better representation. Like, we just need it, right? So, do they exist? I'm sure. Do we see them? Almost never, right?
I feel like Lee from The Walking Dead.
Yes.
Is actually quite a good representation of like a person who has responsibilities and feels the weight of his decisions. And I don't know if you wanted to. Have you played that game, Telltale?
I actually have a lot of feelings about Lee as an example because like a weird trend that popped up in games this day is that everyone who grew up playing games now, of those people, there are now older, of the men who played, they're older men, they have families, they have children, they're still playing the games, so the demographic has moved to, we're going to make the main character a dad. Mm-hmm. So you get things like Joel from The Last of Us, yeah, Lee from The Walking Dead. You put these men in positions of fatherhood. They're protecting some child or something like that. In that case, a lot of them don't seem to really want to do anything other than the Liam Neeson take in, you took my daughter, I have to kill 1,000 men type deal.
Yeah.
Like, I'm just leaving bodies left and right because yeah. Where's my kid?
Yeah.
Where Lee is shown to represent a man who just wants to protect his ward. He has this young girl with him, Clementine. She is just out in this terrible world where terrible things are happening, and then you're encouraged to be a good father to her. You're encouraged to be a good, kind man, as opposed to Last of Us, Joel, I'm going to shoot you in the face and then push your body and make this girl shoot the next guy in the face.
Go ahead. I was excited. Yeah, I've never thought about it, but like Joel is a really interesting example compared to Lee, where he's still this like stoic dude who like, that ending is contentious for so many reasons, but also like that he just makes this decision for her, right? Where I think, and maybe the flexibility in The Walking Dead that you have, you can be a bunch of different kind of fathers to her, maybe.
Right. The final scene in both of those games is real important.
Yeah.
Spoilers. You know what? Spoilers. I'm gonna spoil. I'm spoiling. Sorry, y'all. Those
spoilers,
games.
Spoilers. You'll cry.
Those games are like two years old. Sorry. The end of The Last of Us. Lee comes in. He takes Ellie, and he goes, and he makes the decision for her.
Yeah.
She clearly would have wanted. They imply the entire game. She's trying to help people. She's trying to help the future humanity. He selfishly takes her and goes. The last scene
but
of the
she also knows that.
She does. Yeah, they even show in the end was what happens. Oh, you know, there was no one there. Ignore all the smoking wreckage. Yeah. Where with The Walking Dead, your very last scene of that game is you as Lee and Clementine are in, they're just in a building and Lee's been bitten and is dying. And you have this last moment with the character who's been your daughter this entire time. And you've just, like, it's a touching moment of, like, what that probably should have been as opposed to the selfish man makes the selfish choice. It's, like, the contrast between the two is very interesting.
But do you... Now I'm just doing your job for you. It's the patriarchy in action, you guys.
This is how a chat works.
Listen, Carol. Are there other examples besides fatherhood? Like, I hadn't thought of it that way till you all said it, but then
yeah.
Now I think about it, like, are there other instances where
Lee,
men can
Lee
care?
Lee is a really interesting character, mainly because, actually, in light of what you just said, Robert, there's, you know, in the beginning of The Walking Dead, Lee is essentially being taken to prison, is it?
Yeah.
And it's, basically, as a player, I guess, suspect that he's committed some sort of crime. They have accused him, I think, of murdering a woman, I think.
I don't know, too.
Or at least there's kind of some kind of implication that he has killed someone and he's being taken to prison, except you never know if that's actually true because he hasn't, I don't think he's got a trial yet or whatever, so.
I think he was on his way to prison, like straight to prison.
Yeah, yeah. And I just thought it was really interesting in light of what you said about Joel, because essentially Lee has, you don't know if he's killed anyone, and Joel, throughout the course of that game, he's made to kill hundreds of people, and it's basically the opposite, I guess.
I feel like it's a thing with Naughty Dog, in that they like they like to put you in situations where, like, look at this cool, suave man. Oh man, let's do it. Let's get into the first and foremost, fuck Nathan Drake. Yeah. Let's put that out there. Like, so the Naughty Dog perspective of masculinity is that they take this awful, awful man, and like, you're gonna like this man. You're gonna like this guy. He's bad, but he's like the lovable rogue kind of bad. He makes bad choices, but you know why he's doing them. It's like, so you wind up in this role of this awful, terrible asshole man. He has no problem just murdering people left and right. He knows what's best. He's terrible to everyone he meets. Everything that's happening is a selfish choice. And like, that's supposed to be pitched to me as that's the cool man, the rugged man you wanna like. Like, Nathan Drake is supposed to be Indiana Jones, but has none of the redeeming qualities of Indiana Jones. And like,
yeah, actually,
like that's
really accurate.
That's and that's so prevalent in like how video game men are written. It's like, I don't want to like any of these awful, terrible men. I want to hang out with the cool dad who's taking care of his daughter. Or, yeah, I want to hang out with the cool dad. I don't want to hang out with the other dad who's murdering people.
I mean, it's interesting as well, because in the Walking Dead, it's about the way that the games are structured, right? Because The Last of Us is essentially a game, and Uncharted, their games are about violent systems, and The Walking Dead is actually about a system of dialogue, basically of conversations, I guess, and decisions, right, and talking.
Right.
And what's interesting is that I feel like Lee might be a good representation of masculinity because he solves his problems through talking them through with people. Is that interesting to you?
Well, when I was doing my playthrough through The Walking Dead, I think it was the scene that really jumped out to me was the scene when they were taking into the home. And they were like, oh yeah, we're gonna have this huge dinner. It's gonna be great. Like, we're gonna feed you. Everything's gonna be perfect. And everyone's just like, yeah, this is gonna be great. These people are nice. These people are gonna be we're gonna make it. We're actually gonna make it through this. And then when you find out, like, the friend who was missing is just like, you know, like, pieces of his body are missing, and you're just like, what the fuck? And then you go downstairs, and first thing that Lee sees is this, like, Clementine about to, like put a bite in her mouth, and then you have, like, you see the timer's just like, and you're just it felt like you had, like, a very important mission to do, to be like, no, like, you could have been like, no, just whatever, like, just let her eat it, but for Lee, like, his character, for, like, playing it for that long, and knowing that, you know, he did something wrong, I kind of, like, forgave him. So I kind of put him into, like, a position of power where it's like, okay, you did something bad. Maybe this is a way of trying to, you know, better yourself, like trying to, you know, do something good. Mm-hmm. And I mean, stopping someone from, like, eating another human.
So it's very about redemption.
Yeah.
For you.
Yeah.
I wonder if, like, maybe what isn't interesting about that is, like, The Walking Dead is about, the men in The Walking Dead are dealing with what's happened in the world, where I think we see, like, Nathan Drake is going to exert his will on the world,
yeah,
right? He wants a thing, and he is going to get it. And, like, in, like, The Walking Dead, right, it's...
Wow.
It's a person, like... It's a man reacting to the world, yeah, in, like, a reactive way that maybe we don't really see. And some of that might be, like, a genre problem,
yeah,
too, but...
I think a really interesting point here is mechanics. So, like, a problem with video games is that mechanics... I did not say the, thank God. Last time I said the, and I regretted it. A problem with video games is that the mechanics lend themselves to a specific type of character. So, like, if it's a game where you're fighting all the time, it's going to lend itself to a dude that fights all the time because they want you to be the dude. They want you to be that guy. So you're going to be fighting the whole time. So, of course, this character is going to be way more about murdering everybody rather than talking his way through problems. So mechanics dictate your character.
War.
Sorry?
I just said God of War.
Yes. Yeah. No, exactly. So it's so interesting to see how mechanics are gonna come into play, and being lazy with your mechanics especially is gonna come into play as to what kind of masculinity or what kind of man you're gonna have in your game and represent. And so many games, so many AAA games especially, fall back on what we all know as mechanics, which is, you know, exactly what the problem with men in games is. Well, okay, said the problem again. The only problem with men in games.
the only
problem with men in games is, yeah. No, so that's really interesting to think about. What games could be doing to write stronger men is going to fall on mechanics as much as it is going to fall on the writers. Because the writers are working with something, like if you're making a game, your writer has to work with what you give them, right? They are working around your both mechanics and, like, theme, right? So your environments and that kind of thing. And that's fucked up. That sucks that a lot of writers are find themselves pigeonholed due to that, right? And I think The Walking Dead, they had such a great opportunity because Telltale does this, I mean, any narrative game, I don't want to just say Telltale, but like any narrative game has this opportunity to introduce you to a character through dialogue way more because the expectation's not there. So a player doesn't pick it up and think like, oh, I just want to get to the action. They're not mashing the button through it. They're actually going to read and listen to every single line, right? So narrative has an advantage.
Like, but then also, like, I want to flag, like, if you, like, I'd read an article a while ago about stealth masculinities, and I feel like I wound up, like, shitting on shooters, and, like, as a man, like, but I like shooters, right?
And,
like,
yeah, me too.
Like, and maybe, like, how do we be responsible men about, like, sometimes I want to get drunk and shoot some dudes as a dude. Like, that's cool. Like, that's super fun. And problematic, but fun. And, like, I guess maybe that's, how do we do that?
Yeah, again, like.
Answer, Felix.
Well, no, not the answer, but like an answer is not being lazy, right? So part of that is not making it just about that mechanic, right? That mechanic can be used and it can be fun. Like I have logged like something like 13 days total of Destiny since like in 6 months. Like it's stupid. So I am 100% all about like getting hopping on and playing with some friends and shooting some robots. Like I love it. And or aliens or whatever the hell I'm shooting. And like. Super into it, and like I'm not saying that Destiny has like a great story or anything. That's a whole other discussion. That's an entire different discussion. But the point being that like, yes, if all I'm doing is hopping on to shoot something and then get off again, then that game is probably going to have a much harder time communicating masculinity to me if I'm playing a man in anything other than that, than my goal, which is to hop on and shoot a guy, right? So the responsibility falls on like everything else about the game. It falls on all of your mechanics outside of that, all of the representation outside of that. It falls on like your environments. Like if we want to go back to Nathan Drake, like the trailer for the new Uncharted is like, okay, cool. They're running over a bunch of people of color in a country, and there's no consequences, and they're making jokes in the car the entire time.
He's a bad man, you know?
And I was like, spoilers. this is some dangerous territory here.
Don't let your kids be Nathan Drake.
Yeah. And so, right, and with no consequence. Sticker. So, like, why? Why no consequence? Why do we celebrate that, right? Why do we go in there, especially as developers? So, like, a lot of us are developers here. It's like, why do we choose to make a game in which this type of masculinity is A, what we show off the bat, like the thing we celebrate off the bat before the game even comes out, before it's even done, and B, why is it the main mechanic of the game? Why is being that guy that mechanic? Like, so yeah, it just falls on everything else. It falls on the other stuff in the game.
For me, though, that game is mainly about the relationship between Drake and Sully.
Yes.
Because I think they're a romantic undertone.
Yes.
They're totally doing it.
Yeah, all the time.
Yeah.
We could have a full conversation.
That's the kind of masculinity I can get on board with.
Penalty pointer.
There's a whole conversation about Metal Gear we should probably have.
Yeah.
MB, you could speak to this as well. I feel like the representations of gay men we have in games are super shitty. I don't know if y'all heard Robert Yang talk today. Like, I love the kinds of things he does. But I think, like, actually, I was at a games thing in Boston, and there was this, I went to a diversity panel where there were, like, three people, and this woman from BioWare was there, and she was like, we're the best. Like, we have, you know, a trans character in this, and we have gay characters. And I feel like I was this guy, and I was like, well, you know, like, gay people actually, like, sometimes our partners are alive, and sometimes, like, trans people know other trans people. And, like, she was so mad at me, and I was like, I'm such an asshole. Maybe she's here. I hope she's not here. I'm sorry if she's here. But, yeah, I think we have, like, as gay men, we have such shitty, shitty options.
Yeah,
and you get something, like, coming out on top, where I'm like, oh, my God, like, there aren't enough knives to stab me with.
A lot of the times, whenever I see gay relationships in video games, they're always very tragic.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'm just like, why? Like, that's not the reality. Like, you know, they could have happily sometimes ever after. Like,
we're
why
happy.
Not? But they choose not to go that route, and they just show something that's just, like, far beyond what it could be. And I don't know, like, there has to be a game where it treats it with the respect that it deserves,
right,
as like the people who are playing it, who are from that, you know, that culture.
I think there's no nuance, right? Like, and maybe that's gonna get
in games or
wait, yeah, no. Can you believe it, IndieCade?
So a question that suddenly came up for me is: do you think that they have to make marginalized peoples, if they put a marginalized person in their game, you think they have to make it tragic? Because this is the thing, like, they're all tragic. It's all a tragic story, right? Well, not all, but it is a lot of the time a tragic story. And Do you think that they do that to try and garner pity for that character so that straight, like, cis white dudes are going to want to play as that character if it's something other than them? Like, I worry about that all the time where I'm like, oh, did they only do this to make it so that you had to get attached to this person because they went through something tragic and so you have a reason to want to play as them and, like, help them out? And it's like, oh, you're a savior complex. Now it's a savior complex. Now it's like, oh, if you know, Dorian hadn't been... like, anyway, I've romanced Dorian 4 times in a row, and it was amazing.
Well, I it was the same thing when I played Mass Effect 3, when, oddly enough, I only played Mass Effect 3. I never played 1 and 2, but I'm going to play 1 and 2. But I had 3 at my, I just had it, and I was just like, I'll just play it. And I was like, okay, I'm going to, like I'm ready. I'm, like, I'm ready to save the world. I'm going to, like, romance someone. Like, why not? And I decided to romance Cortez, and that was, like, very awkward, because he's just like, oh, man, like, I'm having such a terrible life, and Shepard's like, yeah, I'm totally there for you, and he's like, yeah, okay. I was like, that's okay, funny. This is,
yeah, bro.
I felt so weird about it, especially since, like, Cortez was the one, like, dropping them off at the battlefield, and you always see him, like, look back, and, like, Shepard's just like, has that static look on his face. I'm just like...
The eternal, I'm holding a box look.
Yeah, and I'm just like, this doesn't seem very real. It's not. It was just really bizarre that they were supposed to be, you know, a thing, and Shepard's like, yeah, I'm going to go save the world, and then Cortez is like, okay, bye. And, it wasn't genuine. I was a little bit
maybe
upset.
You've been in healthier relationships than me. That it seems really genuine.
Riley exclusively dates men who carry boxes.
Carry boxes.
Saves worlds.
I'll remember to put down my profile.
Like that. On Scruff.
I was going to ask, so there are very specific kinds of masculinity we see over and over again, and we've mentioned the kind of, you know, violent bro dudes who turn up and kill everyone. But there's also, I mean, I think... we see a lot of those, particularly in video games that are manufactured in the United States. But actually, we see a very different kind of masculinity come out of Japan.
Yeah.
And I wondered if you had thoughts on that and how violence is handled in Japanese games in particular.
So one of my favorite characters in anything that come out of Japan was Kanji Tatsumi from Persona 4. Yeah. And I have mixed feelings about Kanji. But so Kanji's entire storyline goes, Kanji's this tough boy. He's got his hair's dyed white. He's got a tattoo on his shoulder. He's just, everyone's scared of him. He's just like, oh, that's the dude he'll beat your ass. He doesn't care. But as you get to know him, you, like, his arc leading up is you discover he likes things. His mom runs a textile shop. He likes sewing. He likes cooking. And then when he finally is in the TV and you have to go rescue him, his dungeon is not the best. It's a lot of just too many gay jokes, actually. But it seems to be that his dungeon manifests in that because he doesn't subscribe to traditional masculinity, he's afraid, oh, well, maybe I'm gay, or, oh, maybe people just won't accept me, that I'm girly. So by the time you reach the end of it, he accepts, oh, there are other forms of masculinity. I could be the tough guy who also likes sewing and cooking. And, like, that was really, really striking to me, because I can't think of many other games that, like, delivered that message. Mm-hmm. And then they proceed to, like, pile on gay jokes the rest of the game with him. So, you mm-hmm. know, mixed feelings.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, it's quite a basic kind of concept, isn't it? That, I mean, you can take the parts of, you know, gender, like, socialization that you feel are appropriate for you personally, and that should be okay for everyone. I mean, but it's also really interesting that that game decided to, like, deconstruct that in the way
right.
that it did. And, yeah, no, I think that's really interesting. But I mean, also, I guess masculinity in games has always been predicated on, like, men are things that are not womanly, if you see what I mean.
Yeah,
so it's not, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you think it's, you know, weird that we have, you know, this medium, video games, where we can make any kind of body we like? And make any kind of, like, there's a virtual space where, like, anything can exist. And we still, for example, in Second Life, insist on mm-hmm. having a gender binary, man, woman, and you can only choose those two. And you have to, you know, It's interesting because in Second Life you actually literally have to go and buy a penis if you want to use a penis.
Yeah, it seems especially weird in Second Life, seeing as you can just be a cloud of penises.
Really?
Yeah.
But I had a joined Second Life for a library school project many, many years ago, and then I kept playing it because I found it super fascinating. Maybe that's like a nerdy thing to admit. But I talked to a bunch of people about like the body shame and shit they got. Like I talked to some dude and he was like, when I had like a larger avatar, like people shit on me and all this stuff. And I went to a bunch of like gay parts of it, and it was like, how is this still just like being at a gay club in New York, but we're like on the internet? Like none of this is actually your body. And we're like still being jerks to each other. Like, what? This is terrible.
Do you think that this has anything to do with the fact that we need more diversity in writers? Like, at the end of the day, you're gonna make a game that is within your experiences of the world, and if your dev team is full of people that don't have those experiences, like that aren't, if you don't have any gay people in your team and you don't have any, you know, trans people in your team and that kind of thing, you're never going to be able to represent those experiences. And you actually not only will probably not be able to you won't even think about representing those experiences. It won't even cross your mind. You won't even be like, you don't wake up one day and say like, oh, I'm going to think about this person that is totally not me and I've never even heard of their scenario, right? And of course it comes back to like, I think it has to come back to that, right? It has to come back to like, why is Cortez and Shepard unbelievable? Well, maybe because they didn't have anybody on the team that knew what any sort of relationship was at all. Because that one doesn't make any sense now that I think about it. I was like trying to go there and I'm like, wait, anybody who's ever been in a relationship should know that one. So that's a bad example. But there's gotta be diversity on your team. Or you at least have to go out and talk to people. Like, and I just, so many people don't, right? And so that's got to be part of it, right? I mean, that's...
I feel like, and compounding with that also, so masculinity and race in games are, why is every black man Balrog? Like, it's weird. So it's, there was an article in Offworld just recently, actually, where...
Yeah, I read that one, too.
Basically, really, and they even brought the pictures that a lot of black men in video games are represented as the one type of large, muscular guy with boxing gloves who is rude and likes to punch people. And like
thug life.
Yeah, they have a thug life tattoo somewhere. It's like, why are we all Balrog? But to come back to Lee, he's a good example because, surprise, someone realized, oh, this guy could actually have like a personality and do things. Like, maybe he has interests. And
it's the bar right now. There's a bar.
I just want more men. I just want more men to sometimes have things to do other than the thing they're made to do, which is punch things in a lot of black guys' cases.
Yeah.
Why I feel like consultation is very important, right? Because, you know, if you don't have people with those experiences on a team making these games, then no one's going to know, and people who see it's going to be like, oh, this is my, well, if it's not like a stereotype, I hope it's not a stereotype, but...
Yeah, it's a throwaway, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, thanks for the bone. I really appreciate it.
I'm starting to wonder how many people who are writing these tragic gay men stories have just, their only experience with gay romance have been like sad Netflix movies.
Yeah.
There's a lot of sad Netflix movies. Right. A lot of
they're all sad.
Do not go to the gay section of Netflix.
They're all sad.
Like 90% of the gay movies on Netflix.
Why?
And like at least 75% of them, like one of them either die or they like never, like they're never together, or they're just like, oh no, I guess I'm like straight. And then like the movie just like the credits start rolling.
You what? Are you, like, no. Are you, like,
that was the twist. That was the twist. And I was just like,
actually. Nah, this isn't for me.
And I was just like, where are these, like...
That tracks. If that's what they're watching, that tracks.
Yeah, right.
That might be games right there.
And it just comes back, and then we get Cortez, who's tragic. And
I mean...
But do you think that... I mean, a lot of the representation of marginalized people in video games is tragic and is always portraying marginalized people as having a tragic life. And that's, you know, obviously it's because... The only, you know, experience that people think that we have is like tragedy.
Yeah.
And it's kind of it sucks because obviously our lives aren't entirely tragic. I get, you know, I get up in the morning, I don't think to myself, oh no, the patriarchy is coming to get me.
Don't you though?
I just sit inside of my room and rock back and forth, you know? I mean,
I'm sad right now.
This has been the worst. I mean, it's something I think a lot about being trans. I think when I talk to younger trans folks, there's this idea, I think when you think about like medically transitioning or being trans, because our stories are so terrible, you think you'll just die. Like, you're trans and now you're just gonna die. And something I feel like I always tell younger folks when they're talking about transitioning is, I'm like, you're actually gonna live though. And like, you're gonna be okay, right? You're not gonna wake up every day and be like, oh no, everything is the worst. But also like, the flip side of that is you have to live with all your shit. And so like when we have like this tragic gay romance, like that's so much better than like, oh no, now Cortez and Shepherd are having an argument. What will they do, right? Like, it's, we don't think, those things do bad things to people who view them maybe, but I don't know what's going with this.
The journey is so important. So like, you can't leave the journey out, so it's gonna be tragic. Like, if you're talking about a marginalized person and you leave out their entire journey and you don't talk about the fact that they struggled, you've like erased part of their, like, and I'm not saying that in every game, but like, if that's what you want, if you wanna talk about why they are who they are, you just can't let the journey be the character, right? Like, you need to be able to have a character who has experienced a thing and not let that thing completely define your perception of them. So they have to be more. They have to be themselves as well as their journey. And I think that like that's where a lot of stuff comes into play, where it's like, it's actually really, do you remember when a person released a patch for Dragon Age Inquisition and they wanted to make Dorian straight? They were like, oh, I just want to romance Dorian as a woman. And like everybody, the writers were like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Like, it's important to Dorian's character that he experienced this thing. If you erase that, then his character makes no sense. And I had really mixed feelings about it in the moment, right? Because it's like, okay, well, you've got this man, you've got a representation of masculinity that might be a little bit different than what we're used to. We're all still going out and killing everything at the same time. It's really interesting in that moment to say, okay, what's more important, like what's the real important thing here? Like, are we talking about the journey that this character went through and that's why they're a different representation of masculinity? Yes, in this case. Or are we talking about, oh, this person likes to knit and we're gonna make a bunch of gay jokes about it, which I think is like less, it almost erased his journey. Like, I have a tough time with that one because suddenly you're like, oh yeah, no, he likes to knit and he's this big tough guy, but it's cause he's gay. And you're like, okay, we've now like, so it's a really tough balance. Journey and character are two different things. You have to marry them in the right way. And if you erase one or the other, you're walking in dangerous territory for not, actually at the end of the day, not making a point, right? So I may not have made a point in that entire thing.
A lot of what I did in every field that isn't games, he said, feeling sad about games, is like talking to trans folks about telling stories that aren't just that pain or aren't just that journey, and trying to encourage folks to think about like, what else can we talk about besides how bad we feel all the time? And like,
I think
maybe
we,
games aren't there.
Yeah, maybe. Well, and also yeah, like, you're the only person that can decide whether your pain defines you or not. Like, if that's a thing that you're thinking of, it shouldn't be anybody else that tells you that your pain defines you, right? Yeah. So like, with men in games, a lot of the time it's like it's put on us to be like, oh, but no, their pain defines them, or their struggle, or the fact that they are angry defines them, and we're told that. And I find that really tough because like, games are the one opportunity that I do get to decide. Like, you do feed me information, and then I get to decide what defines this character. And if all you're ever telling me as a player is that their pain defines them or their struggle defines them, then that's how, like, that's, it's just lazy. At the end of the day, it's like kind of lazy, right? And it doesn't help how we think about men in games, and it doesn't help how we think of any character in games, not just men. Anger defining a dude is like, and we've all done it.
Or
we could just move on.
Stoicism.
Or stoicism.
Yeah, right.
Is it ever really stoicism?
Like, I love Adam Jensen, but it's like that man has one emotion, and it's jacket, I think. you know, which is great. I like that you all talk about it. I love his gender.
I think he was sad a whole once.
He was a little bit sad, maybe.
He like got thrown through a window and felt bad about it.
He might have been sad. I don't know. He grunted.
Ugh, I didn't ask for this. Yeah, like.
No. And I think he's great.
Do you think that there should be more diversity in male bodies in video games?
Oh, are we talking about bodies?
Absolutely.
Okay, yeah.
Yes. Because every dude, oh man. To the point where when you start, it's the bodies in games are so homogenous to the point that when you do see the one that deviates, it's usually played as a joke. Like, yeah. I would like to see more characters that have a belly that aren't followed. I would like more dad bods.
Yeah,
put the dad bods in games. No one has ever complained about seeing a dad bod.
You play Firewatch?
I'm probably going to play Firewatch.
He's kind of a little, yeah.
Firewatch. Firewatch is leading the charge on dad bods, thank God.
Yeah.
But like, so we play a game, this is a guy in it, the guy's fat. Okay, great. You see that and you're immediately like, how are they going to joke about this instead of doing anything interesting with this? Like, I play Tekken. I love the character Bob. I would like Bob's body type existing because he basically doesn't exist in any other game except for Street Fighter 4. But Rufus is definitely a punchline. But the thing with Bob is always like, the joke is he shouldn't be as good at martial arts as he is because he's a big guy. It's like, no, how about we like explore why he's good instead, as opposed to the whole
lineup. Have you seen Sammo Hung? He does incredible things with his body, and he is like quite a heavy man, but he's a professional, you know, martial artist.
Right.
And all around cool guy, and he is nimble as hell. And it's kind of really interesting to me that our expectations of fat people are that they're not very mobile and all of these things, and that's clearly not true. So I think we make a lot of assumptions about larger bodies, and I think video games make those assumptions very often as well.
I love a video game man with a good six pack and a beard as much as anyone else. I like led the charge on Hot Ryu, but we definitely need to see more.
Yeah.
And
well,
different. And
Riley wrote a really interesting article on male bodies, like in stealth games.
You sure
right?
did.
Yeah.
Metal Gear wasn't out yet.
I worked really hard for that article not to seem like about body size specifically, and I talked to a bunch of people, and like Todd Harper was super instrumental in talking to me about how to not make it seem sizeist, and I feel anxious about the way that I feel like it still reads as sizeist. If you're here and you read it, I really didn't want that to happen, and I felt weird about it. And it is true, yeah. Oh, I guess you're here. I could talk to you about games journalism and audiences and all kinds of things I didn't think of that aren't valid to that point, but. Yeah, we do have like very limited body types, but that's funny, right? If games are meant to be played by dudes, then like, what does it mean for those dude bodies to be objects? Like, if they're meant to be played by cis dudes, like cis straight dudes, let's presume. Like, what does Nathan Drake's body mean if we're meant to just look through it? And so, what does it mean that it is like?
It's
how it looks, or right, like,
I mean,
it has to be this visible but invisible object at the same
time,
right?
A straight woman point of view, I very much play Uncharted and wish the jeans were tighter.
Yeah,
you know?
His jeans are terrible.
They're really just too baggy for everything.
God, yeah, no, and it bothers me simply because, you know, I play a lot of other games where there's like a, if it's a, say, a third person game and it's a woman character, there's definitely a silhouette there.
Yeah.
And your article is really interesting because it also addressed the fact that like stealth games make that silhouette happen for men's bodies.
Right,
and
totally.
I mean, I wonder what it feels like for men to actually finally have that kind of objectifying gaze on their bodies, I guess.
I think like what I like about stealth games is maybe going back to like what we were talking about The Walking Dead is the way that instead of being a dude who's busting through a space, you are like a man in stealth games where you're a man who's asked to like work with what's around you. Like you meet your goals and get your needs met by being careful or this or that. And I find that model to be inching towards a positive model of masculinity in some way, where instead of being Nathan Drake and being like, give it, you're like, oh, this is interesting, right? Like I'd like that kind of about like volume, like the character in volume is this like teenage nerd, and I'm like, what are you doing? Neat. Like, what a neat character to have to play. Like, cool. And I think maybe we need more of, and there's a lot of gaps in me, like, saying that as a, because even stealth game characters are, like Adam Jensen, are always, like, emotional children, right?
Yeah.
And that kind of sucks, but I think.
Sad only once.
Yeah, right.
But it's really interesting maybe. As well, I feel like, like you were saying before, that the traditional model of masculinity is this Nathan Drake character who basically, I guess, provokes his environment.
Yeah.
And then there's another alternative model, which we found more positive, I guess, on this panel, which is that that particular man will actually deal with his environment as is, and
yeah,
is adapting to his environment and understands,
yeah,
like, how to actually traverse the environment without having to unleash hell constantly,
yeah,
and try and change it. And I think that's really interesting, because that's,
yeah,
something video games have said to us that I think is really revealing to me personally about how our culture works.
Oh, yeah, I mean, what would you rather teach young people playing a game, right? That they, especially young boys, that they like should always try and muscle their, like, not muscle, but that they should always try to destroy their environment if they don't enjoy it, or if they should work through it, right? Like, and I know you said this isn't not gonna be a cause and effect panel, but like, that's a really important thing. It's really important to understand that the people that you play your game might actually internalize that thing that you're encouraging, right? And in order to break free of that, they're gonna have to adapt to whatever it is that you, a creator, are throwing at them. Like, that's part, it's a weird cycle of, like,
yeah,
well, why did you put them in the scenario if you didn't want them to come up with a creative, interesting human way of dealing with it, right? Instead, you just, the obstacle is just there for them to tear down or change for their own like success, I guess, like win state, right?
Yeah.
And that, I think everybody can agree that that just makes for a better game, right? That the idea of adapting and having to work with your surroundings as opposed to against it is super, like, interesting, relatively, I assume. I don't actually know. Maybe,
I mean, I guess it's about being, games like that are, like, about being a man in the world, I guess, which is maybe an interesting thing. Yeah, no, right?
Oh, God.
But it's maybe an interesting thing to have. I mean, all right, audience, how do you walk around responsibly as a man in the world? It is a really difficult thing, and I don't think any of us have good models about that.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah, I mean, do you think that the fact that, like, the typical male fantasy of this kind of model of violent masculinity, I mean, why does it crop up so often, do you think?
A long time ago, we all watched Die Hard. And it kind of like, I honestly feel.
It's just Die Hard.
That's
our root.
A lot of games seems to be chasing the dream of being respected as film, and as a result, kind of cribs a lot from film.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of our games are summer blockbuster action movies, mm-hmm, put in interactive form. As said, Uncharted is basically Indiana Jones with all the nice parts of Indiana Jones stripped, but in general, we kind of come back to these violent male fantasies of blow this up and feel good about it, because just media in general keeps portraying this blow this up, feel good about it.
But it's so interesting to me that, like, I mean, the film I think that has one of the biggest influences on video games is Aliens.
Right.
Which
is
stars a woman.
Yep.
And even in the most recent Aliens Colonial Marines game, there was no Ripley. She was kind of conspicuously absent. Women were basically written out of it. And it's really interesting to me that even if we're looking at film as being this big influence on video games, that we are still kind of more comfortable with having men perpetrate violence. And these kind of other narratives. I think it's just really, really, really interesting that it, you know, that's one of our biggest influences. You can see the influence of Aliens all over video games, but no woman.
Yeah, because now that you mention it, Alien Isolation. Isolation came out, when you do play as a woman in that game,
yeah,
you're actively running
no
and
comment.
Screaming
yeah.
from the alien who's chasing you the whole
yeah.
game. And if you're ever in a combat situation, it's probably bad for you. So,
probably. Do you all think there are any games that portray like men and women having healthy relationships? He asked the panel and then sat back.
What?
Like
I don't understand.
Are there like you're saying like when you're a woman you're like are there games that have men behaving in emotionally healthy ways?
I think that Tim Schafer's games do those very well.
Yeah.
There are a number of games I think that I mean it's mainly because he's very good at comedy and thinks that anyone can be funny. And I think that's a very egalitarian way of looking at the world is you know, how can all these people be funny? How can they all be different from each other? How can they all bicker and argue in an entertaining way? And I remember I wrote an article about Full Throttle, and I think that Maureen is a really interesting portrayal of someone who typically would have been painted as the romantic interest for the main character, Ben, but then at the end, they're just friends. And it's just a lovely story about a man who looks like a very man's man, wears a biker jacket, he's the head of like a biker gang. You know, the only two things you can really do in the game is punch, kick, punch, kick. And it's a game that's essentially about conversation, so I think that that's very funny, but really Ben is actually quite a gentle person and he doesn't really use violence very often. So it's quite an interesting game, I think. How about you guys? What do you feel?
I shouldn't have asked this question.
Yeah, I can't really think of a game where, you know, they would use that role properly, at least. But that's definitely something I would like to see, you know, implemented in more games and have more of a diverse, you know, like people who are like just in general like a very diverse, you know, team working on something like that to make it more relatable to the player. Because I feel like if a game is very relatable, you tend to enjoy it more as opposed to, you know, like random shit happening all over the place and you're just like, or you're just like sitting there watching. You don't feel like, you know, you're with the character, you're just like watching the character. You literally put down the controller, you're just watching things happen. You don't feel like you're part of anything.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like, yeah.
Do you think that men, as represented in games, are going to become, or at least are on a path to becoming more human? And I say that in like a very, because really there's a difference between like a man in a game and they're like a representation of violence or a representation of what we consider to be masculine. It just so happens to be within a sprite or a like, you know, asset that is a man shape. And like that versus them having some human quality, right? Because like if they're not human, if they don't have some quality that anybody can relate to, because a human implying, sorry, like anyone can relate to it, then like we're only ever getting more realistic in graphics. We're never getting more realistic in any other way.
Yeah.
And so you can make someone that looks exactly like the guy you used to live next to, and you only like he fixed his car every day outside, and it's great, and he looks exactly like him. But if he has no human qualities, what does that mean, right? I have no idea if anyone writing Men in Games is interested in making men more human, and that to me is like top is like 100% like what needs to happen, right?
That's really interesting.
It also seems like every time you hear the words, we're writing this man to be more human, they seem to like completely miss the target and just fall further and further into the pre-existing frameworks of tough manly man who does tough manly things. It's like this man has no wants, no desires, no interests.
Yeah, exactly. They have no vulnerabilities, particularly emotionally speaking.
No. I would like Adam Jimson to be sad more than once in this new Deus Ex. I don't think it's gonna happen. He might get mad.
It's like I think it's like the John Wick model, isn't it?
Oh, yeah,
it's like there are two emotions.
The John Wick model.
There's sad because
game,
Poppy has died and rage, and that's it.
There. Once again, he was happy once in that movie. New puppy.
Wait, new puppy.
Right.
Was he even happy about that new puppy?
He didn't.
Yeah.
He got the new puppy. He was like, oh, there's a new puppy. It replaces the one that my wife got me when she died. I'm also sad about my dad. Oh, right. That movie just. Go see John Wick.
It's real good.
But do you think that it's because masculinity is essentially invisible because it's the default thing, and we all just assume it's there and it's just taken as read that this is what a man is. There's no attempt to actually address the way that men actually might feel about their own identity. There's never any focus on male identity because feminists do a lot of work on you know, women's representation, but there's no real work being done on male representation.
A lot of any conceptualizing on masculinity and how it manifests always seems like written as like aliens discovered humans and tried to write what they see in men. Like this man eats steak and smokes cigars. That's cool. Like it always seems to be pushing towards the traditional manly man. It never wants to explore any other avenue, any other anything. Our vulnerabilities, what we're scared of, what makes us cry. Why do that?
That's bad for all of us, I think, as men in games, that we are given these terrible models, and I, at least as a trans guy, have seen like a lot of trans guys go on to be terrible because those are the only models that you have, and I think it's like, it seems given that it seems like there's so many more important things to talk about. It feels really hard to say like those, if we're only told that we can be this like stoic badass, like that does really stink for us, right? Like the ways that you can't, that it's so hard to be allowed to be a man who has the full range of human emotions. And I think we talk about this when we talk about feminism all the time, right? That like, I still think the solution to most like men's problems is still feminism. Like
it's basically,
you're just a person. It's okay to be a person.
It feels like, basically, when you're told you can only be one way so long, you never even consider you can be another way.
Yeah.
And then once,
and it's like terrible.
Once you kind of deviate from that way, you think there's something wrong with you, and that's terribly unhealthy.
You're allowed to be sad. It's okay. If you're a man in the audience, you're allowed to be sad. It's okay.
Crying is okay.
Even if it's not your puppy. But whatever.
Only two emotions. Yeah.
Sad and
rage.
And fury.
Anyway, I feel like we're coming up on the end of our talk. We've got like a few minutes to talk about something. If you feel like there's something you really got to say, burning you up.
I really want to tell the story about something that happened to me last night at the awards thing. If you were at the awards thing last night and you are a man, you will know that the bathroom only had two urinals and a toilet. And I had to pee, and there was a huge line for the men's room and not a huge line for the girls' room. And I was like, this is awesome, because like everywhere you go, there's always a huge line for the girls' room. And as someone who's been on both those sides, I was like, yes, like, go girls, go speedily through the bathroom. We deserve this. And I had this terrible moment where I realized, oh gosh, I have to pee and I'm trans. What am I going to do? And I had thought like, oh, I bet I could ask the girls, so like, let me use the girls' room. And then I was like, no, like, you made your bed. You lie in it, man. Like, that's shitty. And so I feel like all these men were behind me in line, and I was just like, hey, men behind me in line, I'm trans, and I'm about to squat to pee. That's cool. And everyone was really cool about it, and it was this really interesting moment, I thought, as I was squatting to pee in front of all these strange men, of like thinking about how I didn't trust those men with that necessarily, and how I was sort of like proud of them for like, not proud of them for like not just being jerks, but I had this whole, you know, meaningful thought about how homosociality and how we relate as men also while like frantically squatting and peeing out free beer, which was delicious. About like, the beer, not the pee. No. That would have been a very different party, I think. But I feel like it made me think a lot about the ways that maybe men aren't allowed to trust each other with their bodies and stuff. And I was like, well, how do men deal with this? What a weird freaking man situation that we're having. And it was really interesting. It made me think a lot about this talk. And I wanted to tell that story.
Yeah. That's a good story. Do you feel like IndieCade is an environment that's more likely to, you know, be
totally
okay with all of these issues?
Yeah, like everybody was very cool.
Yeah.
As I loudly announced I am trans and squatting to pee.
Cool.
Can we also talk about what a terrible design that is?
Yeah, right?
I'm a cis man. If I walk and I'm taking a shit and there's a guy next to me taking a piss, it's awkward for both of us.
Oh my God.
That is kind of weird.
Are we going to talk? What's happening?
The idea that men are supposed to be automatically okay with each other's genitals constantly.
Yeah, right? Like, they're just supposed to be. But I think that goes back to what we were saying before. I feel like men aren't supposed to have any needs about their bodies. So, like, of course you would just poop in front of strange men.
No!
Right?
Never!
I mean, no, right?
Who like, is man. That man who's watching me poop?
I don't know.
Hey, dude, I'm gonna just be here doing my thing. No, no, I'm a shy pooer.
And maybe that's what we need, right? Maybe we need, like, stalls, and maybe we need nicer men's room. Maybe that's the solution. Men are allowed to have, like, feelings about, like, going to the bathroom.
Well, I think that's what we can take away from this talk, is that men shouldn't
y'all
have
a
to poop
couch in
front
bathroom.
Of other men. That's,
no one should have to poop in front of another person. We evolved and moved out of the jungle so we
unless
can
it's
poop.
What you want.
Well, thank you very much. This has been amazing. Thank you so much.